Hello, I'm Helen Foray. According to a University of Florida survey, consumer confidence statewide is in its lowest point, particularly in the wake of the federal government shutdown and debt ceiling debate. This trend doesn't help what Governor Rick Scott has been trying to accomplish since he took office, which is calm investors' fears, entice companies to relocate to Florida, and spur economic growth, job growth in particular. Given this study, what's the governor to do? We ask him to that as he joins us on Issues. Governor Rick Scott, thanks for being with us today.
We could change the federal government and get them to act responsibly, cut taxes, cut regulation, make it easier to get a permit and get in business. But in the meantime, since that's probably not going to happen soon, we're going to continue to recruit companies, cut taxes, cut fees, pay down debt. The way I think about it is make it a place where your business can succeed. I mean, the way I think about this and why I do it is I grew up in a family that struggled for jobs. I think about how do we create an environment where my parents could get a job? Well, the way we're going to do it is make companies more successful.
But when you say make companies more successful, I mean, Florida's always has no income tax. It's a low tax state, relatively speaking. So why has it been so difficult to be able to, why do we have car manufacturing plants in Alabama and we can't get them in Florida?
Well, first off, we didn't recruit them. Right after I got elected in 2010, I sat down with site selectors. There's 6,000 site selector firms in the country. I said, what do you think about Florida? They said, well, you have some good local economic development teams, but at the state level, people won't even return our phone calls. If you even want to do something, it'll take you years. So what I've done is, I think about it this way. You're not willing to pay more money to a company for a product or service because they have higher taxes or more regulation costs them to comply with or a longer permitting process or the uncertainty of government. So by cutting regulation, that reduces their cost. Streamline the permitting process helps them get into business faster, cutting their cost. We do have taxes and fees that we don't need. So we've cut property taxes, business taxes, got rid of a sales tax on machinery and equipment, all those things. On top of that, it looked like we were going to be downgraded in our state debt. That would scare somebody to open up a business here because, gosh, are you going to raise taxes? We've paid off $3.6 billion of the state debt and the $3.5 billion we owed the federal government on unemployment debt. And then I've gone and recruited companies. I've gone on Squawk Box and, Bloomberg TV and did forums and call companies. I mean, I call companies all the time. And guess what? It works. 365,000 plus private sector jobs. So the private sector is adding jobs. So hopefully my parents could have gotten a job. My children are getting jobs. Now I have grandchildren. I want them, to be able to get a job.
You know, when we look at where a lot of companies are relocating, it seems like Central Florida and Northern Florida. And when I say northern, it's not panhandle, it's like Jacksonville and so on. They're doing great. South Florida is very different. What about job creation and growth in South Florida?
Well, if you look at Broward, they've done really well. If I brag about one person, you'll think I'm not bragging about somebody else. But
no, go ahead, brag.
The Beacon Council does a good job. And unemployment's gone from, I think, when I got elected, 12.4, I think, or 12 point something, and it's a little over 8. So that's a big move. Statewide, we're down from 11.1 to 7, so 4.1. So the truth is, Miami-Dade is done, it's come down as fast. It's still a little higher than our statewide average, but Broward's below our statewide average. So we are making progress. We've got a lot of announcements. Yesterday, or this week, I announced 200 jobs or 600 jobs really with AT&T down in Miami. Most have been down in Miami. But just this week, gosh, we did 600 jobs in Melbourne, 105 jobs in Orlando, 200 jobs yesterday in Jacksonville, 600 jobs with I think 360 of them were in Miami. So we are making progress. But until everybody has a job like my parents, we're not, we've still a lot of work left to do.
One of the big issues, of course, has to do with home ownership and the foreclosure issue. It's hard to get past that huge hurdle that's affected a lot of states in the Sun Belt, but Florida and Nevada are one of the highest.
Although we've really had a big improvement. If you look, when I became governor, there was somewhere between 10 and 20-year supply of condos in Miami. Those are gone. A lot from Latin America and Europe came in and bought. We're building more now. Home prices are up. Home sales are up. We probably have the lowest inventory of years of homes on the market across the state. So we're making a lot of progress. Now, look, the federal government, you know, they need to act responsibly. We can't have higher corporate taxes than the rest of the world. We can't have more regulation than the rest of the world. We can't have a bad attitude towards business and think business is going to prosper. So we are doing well, but we could do better with a better run federal government.
When you talk about better run federal government, over the last week and a half, there's been so much discussion about Obamacare and how it's affected. Well, we know the website, healthcare.gov, has been what everybody would say, a disaster. But you also look at where you really see immense expansion has been in Medicaid. Where is Florida when it comes to Medicaid expansion? Seems like we want to be a part of it, but in a way we don't want to be a part of the new federal expansion program.
Well, let's think about what Obamacare did. It didn't focus on the right things. It didn't focus on the cost side. The problem with health care is it costs too much. It's not, I mean, look, if we can figure out how to make health care more affordable, then that's going to help everybody. So to fix it, what we need to do is we need to have more choice. We need to allow you to buy the insurance you want to buy, because, you know, you might want to buy something I don't want to buy because you know your body better than I know. You know, your body might be different.
Or choose my own doctor.
You ought to be able to choose your own doctor. You ought to be able to get the same tax breaks an employer gets for buying insurance. Why should an employer get a discount and you or get a tax break and you don't? You should be rewarded. Don't smoke. Eat right. Exercise. But let's look at what's actually happened. Just a week ago now, Blue Cross said 300,000 people would not have their individual policies anymore. I talked to individuals around the state. They might be part of a trader association. They've lost their health insurance. They might be part of a company that helped them provide it, and they lost that. I've talked to people all over the state. That's what's happening to them, because what's happened under Obamacare is they said, "Oh, if you don't have all, it don't cover all these things, you can't sell that type of insurance." So, it's going to hurt so many people. It's the opposite of what the president said. The president said, "Oh, if you like your health plan, you can keep it." That's not true.
What about is there any way? Because there's a lot of discussion, and Democrats would say, and a couple of weeks ago we had Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz sitting where you are today, and she said, "You know, we've got to fix the law. There are aspects of it that we have to amend. All laws," she says, "have to be amended." I think by and large that's absolutely true. What can you backpedal from Affordable Care Act to make it better?
You know, look, I think they need to start all over and say, and look at what actually works. Competition works. I mean, that generally prices get lower, service gets better in every industry, it will in healthcare. Give you the opportunity to decide for yourself. I think they have to step back, and Obamacare doesn't believe in any of those things. It doesn't believe in your individual choice. It doesn't believe in more competition. It doesn't believe in giving you a tax break so you buy your own policy. So then if you ended up with something, you wouldn't lose your policy when you change jobs. It doesn't reward you for eating right, exercising, don't smoke. It doesn't do any of those things. They need to step back and say, let's go with what actually works. Those things would actually work. And that's what companies were actually doing. They were giving you more choice. They were rewarding you for taking care of yourself. And Obamacare did just the opposite.
One of the things that you had talked about is that in your 4 years, or almost 4 years, you were looking at reducing taxes statewide. At one point, that also included taking money out of education. You put money back into education. You're talking about reducing taxes even further. At what point does that make sense without actually hurting budgets? You're talking about cutting budgets across the board. How do you do that without affecting education, without affecting health care, without affecting those that really need much more from state government?
Well, as you know, I walked in with a $3.6 billion budget deficit my first year, and what was happening with a lot of it is the federal government was cutting back on all the stimulus money that ran through the state budget. So what we've actually done in education, we've increased funding for education. We've got the highest funding from the state for K-12 education in the history of the state. We've increased it over $1 billion the last 2 years. We guaranteed our teachers a pay raise for the first time ever in the history of the state, and it's working. Our fourth graders are number two in the world in reading. Think about that, number two in the world. Hispanic students, highest graduation rates in the country in Florida. The National Council for Teacher Quality says we have the most effective teachers. highest improvement in achievement scores for our students in fourth and eighth grade of any large state. So actually, we've increased funding for K-12. And the reason, we're going to have the highest general revenue in the history of the state. You know why? People are moving here. People are getting jobs. The number of people on unemployment has dropped from 568,000 when I started to about 245,000. So actually what we've been able to do is increase things in areas. For the first time in 8 years, get people off the wait list that were developmentally disabled. And the reason is one, people are moving here. Two, 365,000 people have gotten jobs that didn't have them when I became governor. And we've watched how you spend money. What do you, everybody at home has to say, set your priorities. You know, how can I do this less expensively? That's what I expect. That's what you should expect out of your government. Can't you figure out a way to do this more efficiently? And that's what we've done. We've rebid things. And my goal right now is to find another $100 million worth of savings. My goal is to pay down more debt. We've paid down $3.6 billion worth of state debt and eliminate that debt that we owe the federal government on unemployment. So ours works. Ours is a growing economy. That's how we're able to do this.
Common Core in favor of it or not in favor of it?
Here's what I'm excited about is we have a great Commissioner of Education, Pam Stewart, a very good Board of Education led by Gary Chartrand, and here's what they're saying, which I agree with. We'd have high standards, but you know what? There'd be Florida standards. We don't need the federal government telling us how to run our education system. We care about our students, and it's working. So my goal is have high standards, measure everything, reward success, have a measurement system that works for the state of Florida.
I am told former Florida Governor Charlie Crist is, well, definitely running for governor, even though he hasn't officially announced. He's going to concentrate a lot of his time in South Florida to really galvanize votes for the Democratic Party. How do you see Charlie Crist, and how are you going to run against his campaign?
Gosh,
I know it's a hypothetical campaign, but sure. You know it's there.
See, well, here's what I do every day. I think about my parents struggling for jobs. I think about my daughters and son-in-laws and grandchildren. I say, look, I want them to have a job. I want them to have the best education system possible. And so what I do every day is I get up and say, how do I help individuals like that? So they need a job. They want the best education system possible. They want to live a safe environment. They want a low cost of living. And that's what I ran on in 2010. That's what I've tried to do every day as governor. And that's what I'm going to keep doing.
Governor Rick Scott, thanks so much for joining
us
today on Issues. Up next, our panel discussion. Stay with us. Our next guests are here to weigh in on my interview with Governor Rick Scott and to discuss other state issues we might have left off the table. We welcome Marily Cancio, former Republican congressional candidate and attorney at the office of Marily Cancio Johnson. Michael Hernandez, Democrat and Senior Director of Governmental and Public Affairs at Penn Sean Berland. Doug Lyons, Senior Editorial Writer and Columnist at the Sun Sentinel. And Manuel Lasaga, a Finance and Economics Expert and President of StratInfo and Clinical Professor of the Department of Finance and Real Estate at FIU. Thank you all for being here. Ladies go first. Marily Cancio, very quickly. I thought the governor was very focused. He seems so much more comfortable. He has very clear in mind how he wants to present his administration these first 4 years before he goes into reelection. How do you see it?
I see it the same way, Helen. I think he's doing a fantastic job, and he has the numbers to prove it. So I think that's going to help his reelection campaign next year. He ran in a campaign of 700,000 jobs in 7 years. He's already achieved over 365,000 private sector jobs while reducing the size of the government. Our unemployment rate has gone down. Now we're going to have a surplus of over $800 million, and he wants to give $500 million, $500 million back to the people of the state of Florida, and he's going around the state asking how we want that tax break. So I think he's doing a fantastic job for the state of Florida.
Michael Hernandez, no question, no secret, you are a Democrat. How do you see it?
And I believe that the Governor Rick Scott's probably a very nice guy. He's presenting his case for reelection. I noticed he hit on all the themes that his pollsters are probably telling him to hit and to sound less partisan because, frankly, people are sick of politics, whether it's in Washington or Tallahassee. They want people to resolve their issues. But I think it's going to be very difficult for Governor Scott. You mentioned I'm a Democrat, but I'm trying to not be partisan here. When you look at polling He consistently averages in the high 30s, low 40s. That's not a winning formula. Marily, I agree with you that we need to add jobs. Heck, I want a tax cut too. But he did campaign and PolitiFact checked it. He said 700,000 jobs in 7 years on top of natural job growth, which was projected at 1 million over the next 10 years. So it's really 1.7 million jobs that we were supposed to see in about 7 to 10 years. We're not going to see that. We're at 365,000. That's not all the governor's fault. I'm not saying that. But that's going to be, if that's the central point of his campaign, I don't know that he wins re-election.
And Manuel Lazaga, very quickly, going into these economic issues, how does Florida fare in comparison to other states?
I think that, first of all, let me say this is the fourth year of a recovery, an expansion, actually. Maybe many people don't feel it that way. So because of that, we've had some job growth. The difference, and I think the Florida is pretty much at the norm compared to the rest of the nation. We're basically on the average. U.S. employment may be growing at, let's say, 1.7%. We may be growing at 1.6% in terms of jobs. The thing is that we lost about 850,000 jobs, more or less during the period of the recession. That was 4 years ago. And so we haven't probably recovered about half of them. We're growing probably about half the rate of growth that we would normally expect. So we have seen improvement, but there's a long way to go. As you mentioned on the tax revenues, I mean, our fundamental pillar of tax revenues is sales taxes. Well, one of the good things about this recovery is consumer spending. So that has helped to increase the state coffers. On the other hand, we're dealing with the real estate sector that's still fairly depressed. South Florida was particularly hard hit. I think the only other place where you lost more money in the real estate market was Las Vegas versus South Florida. So I think that there's some hurdles to overcome. But I think the policies we're seeing in the state, I think, distinguish it in a better way than, unfortunately, our federal government that seems to be upping the debt ceiling and not worrying about reducing the size of the deficit. So I think that that's a plus.
Doug Lyons, from an editorial page perspective, how do you see this?
Well, I think it's a mixed review for the governor. I mean, he's been very strong about job growth and at least trying to get jobs here. He's been very strong on things like port development. I mean, Port Everglades likes what he's done as far as trying to get federal money and state money to do its dredging. But I think he's got a hurdles is the right word. I think he has hurdles with his economic platform, and more importantly, I think he has really big hurdles with his education platform. He didn't mention that he initially came in cutting education K-12. Now he's talking about it rebounding. He also didn't mention his, I don't want to call it a flip-flop, but he initially was a big supporter of Common Core standards, and now suddenly, you know, it's a Florida-only thing. So I will say one set of numbers that he does have going for him is money. He's got $18 million and growing in his ECO account, and I think we saw the governor beginning to get in campaign mode with his performance here.
So, Marily, as a Republican, do you see it kind of like with, you know, rosy glasses because you think he's doing absolutely great, but yet there are hurdles, and any candidate would have hurdles. Charlie Crist would certainly have enormous hurdles, too, because he's also flip-flopped as much as anybody else.
No, I think that Charlie Crist has flip-flopped more than anybody else. But I think that Rick Scott has hurdles to be reelected. I agree that his numbers, his polling numbers are low. But I truly believe that people of Florida are tired of politics, and they don't want a politician. And if they want a career politician, they would not pick Rick Scott. But if they want someone that it's a manager, that it's managing the state as a company, as a CEO, I think he would be reelected.
But, you know, the Republican brand nationwide is not held in high regard. If we want to look at polling, for example, doesn't that hurt him?
Look, he's a governor, and he wanted to get some of the tax dollars from Washington, even though the Republican Party didn't want to. So I think he's a leader, because when you stand on your own in important issues, regardless of what the party says, that shows leadership. And I think Rick Scott has demonstrated a lot of leadership in Tallahassee, which is very refreshing. So we still have a long way to go till next year.
We have a long way to go. I completely agree with that. In 1 year, that's a millennium in politics. And as Doug was saying, Governor Scott, you need to be a successful political candidate. You need campaign funds. He's not going to have any shortage of them. And frankly, he has an advantage over my party right now, because if you saw in 2010, my party doesn't show up to vote in midterm elections. And if Democrats show up to vote anywhere near the levels that they did in 2012, even if independents somehow broke for Governor Rick Scott and all Republicans came out, the Democrat can win.
But in 2012, there was this huge drive by the Democrats to organize and to deliver the state for the president, which they did successfully. That's not been dismantled. I think it's there to try to not only win the governorship, but also to change the balance in Congress as well.
I don't disagree with you. And I'm not blaming the Florida Democratic Party or the Miami-Dade or Broward Democratic Parties. What I'm saying is, it's tough to get that, you know how you rate voters from 1 to 5, 5 being a super voter that votes for dog catcher every single election. Those ones and twos, the ones that don't participate very often, that's who the Obama campaign was so successful in identifying. And if you could get those ones and twos out to vote, whether you're a Republican or Democrat, more than likely you're going to be successful.
I know you guys want to jump in, but let me just pick his brain just a little bit more here. When it comes to polling, and you look at what does Governor Scott's numbers have been relatively consistent, what does he need to do to make that qualitative step to get past where he is today?
You're asking me to advise the Republican governor.
Please do, Michael.
I think he has excellent pollsters. He has excellent advisors. Be a partisan. That's the way that you have to frame yourself in this political environment. I know I'm a young guy, but I've never seen it so ideologically divided in this country. And I'm talking about in state governments and at the federal level. Be a partisan, be a problem solver, whether it's him or anyone else, Democrat or Republican.
Doug.
Let me try to answer your question. I think the governor has one thing going for him in the polls. I think his kind of management approval ratings are so-so. His likability, not so much. But he can build on that, you know, his job approval by saying, you know, I'm a consistent manager and CEO of the state. And he can contrast that against his likely opponent, Charlie Crist. You know, he tried to raise his likability numbers. That's a harder sell for him. But I think he can make a case as being a manager of
Manuel Lazaga.
I think the governor also stepped in with good timing. He steps in at a time when the economy was first starting to breathe after a recession. And I think in that sense, he's managed it well. In other words, the wave of growth was starting to happen. We're not growing as fast, but those policies have contributed to that. Now, I think we need to go back to the hurdles. I think healthcare reform is going to crash in a way against a brick retaining wall, because it was a total misconfigured exchange system where there was a magic wand that was going to have insurance companies cut insurance rates in half. That doesn't work. The numbers don't add up. So I think the state's going to have to face the issue of uncovered citizens of the state in terms of health insurance. That's going to go back to challenge the budget. And as my colleagues were saying, education, that still needs, if we're going to be a top state in regeneration of jobs, we have to be a top state in educating our future business and community leaders.
And I agree. And I think that the governor is very well aware of that. And that is why he has instituted pay raises for all the teachers in the state. He's putting $1 billion in education. He just allowed $80 million for the medical school at FIU. I think this is a government that it's committed to the success of this state. In order for people to get jobs in the state, you must be educated. And for example, we have the $10,000 degrees in all the colleges in the state of Florida. We have the most affordable education for great education in the state. So I'm very positive and optimistic of the future of our state.
Doug, we only have like 2 minutes left. We are probably looking at, Marilee said something that I thought was really compelling. If you are looking for a professional politician, Rick Scott's not the guy for you.
Correct.
Charlie Crist might be looked at as a professional politician, or at least a career politician.
Correct.
How do you see a race, assuming Charlie Crist jumps in, and let's face it, can we assume otherwise?
I don't think so. I mean, Charlie Crist is by all intents and purposes, he's in. He will be fighting for that Democratic nomination. His problem is if he can get the nomination. I mean, I know the establishment is backing him to the hilt, but he's a convert. And there are some Democrats out there that want to want to see him really prove that he's a real Democrat. I actually think it's going to be a close race. I mean, the poll numbers show that, at least initially, that Charlie's got to lead. But you can't discount the Republican Party's they are closing ranks against Charlie Crist, and they will support Rick Scott. And
when somebody says poll numbers, we always have to look at you, Michael. Poll numbers, that's going to be a race to watch.
It is, and like Doug was saying, we're a year out, so it really doesn't matter. I understand that
at what point do poll numbers really become a critical issue in your mind when you have, within a year, at what point do we look and to say...
The trend is usually irreversible when it comes to personal likability about 3 months out. About 3 months out, voters will just basically say, I personally don't like him. Now, do I want to rehire him or do I want, in this case, it would be rehiring either one because they've both been governor. But about 3 months out, you have to change your likability. George W. Bush was excellent for that. Even though as a Democrat, you have to note that people liked him more. They liked him personally more than they liked John Kerry. They returned him to office. If this is a personality contest, it hurts Governor Scott. If it's more of a partisan managerial, mm-hmm. it'll probably help him.
That's such a good point. Rehiring both of them. They're both running for re-election.
I like the mantra. It's working. It's working.
We're out of time. I'd like to thank all of my guests for joining us today. Thank you for watching. I'm Helen Ferre. See you next time.